Hello everyone. A very good morning to all of you. We are very excited to see so many of you who have joined us in celebrating this Open Day 2021. We are glad that in this pandemic time also, we all managed to come together to be a part of the scientific community. This virtual mode of celebration has given us the opportunity to not just limit this event to a single day. We'll be having a series of talks that will be happening in the coming 3 days. We are extremely thrilled to walk you through the amazing work that has been happening in CCMB and our contribution to the advancement in science. To take this thrill to a next level, all the talks will be followed up by amazing quizzes and games along with a panel discussion. We hope that you enjoy the series of lectures and get motivated to be a part of our community. Now I would like to welcome Director CCMB, Dr. Vinay Nandapuri, and ask him to please say a few words to all of you.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to welcome all of you for this Open Day celebration at CSIR CCMB. Andariki na swagatam. CCMB tarapuna. Last 1 year has been quite tough on most of us. One and a half years has been quite tough on most of us. And most of you guys, students specifically, have been having classes and other things of online. We are fully aware of the challenges that are associated with online studies, such as bandwidth problems and other problems that happen. Every day, every year, Open Day at CCMB is celebrated with a lot of zest and zeal. And almost 5,000 to 10,000 students used to come in person till 2019 to attend the Open Day celebrations at CCMB. Unfortunately, for the last 2 years, we are unable to conduct this in person. And I'm gratified to see that approximately 500 participants are there, even though this Open Day celebrations are actually conducted online. And we really hope that we will be able to change this going forward next year, and we will get back to having Open Day presentations and Open Day celebrations in person. The purpose of the Open Day is basically for students to understand science at its basic level and have a first-hand experience of how science is performed and what kind of techniques we use, what kind of equipments we use towards actually getting to the point of discoveries. And these are which are necessary for actually fundamental discoveries in science. The idea is actually that some of you would be excited and influenced by what you see and pursue science in its purest form, research, and with all the enthusiasm. That's what we hope for. And we would like that to happen. I do understand that it may not be the same experience when you're doing it online compared to in person. As I acknowledged already, it will happen most probably by next year. We'll see. So the importance of science has not been more apparent than the last 1.5 years, if you really think about it. Before COVID pandemic came by, I'm sure the science students know about all the things that need to be known about mRNAs and other things. But, you know, now public at large know of many terms which were so-called specific, RT-PCRs, mRNA, RNA viruses, and then even things like variants. There is mutations that occur in the viruses. We are proud of the fact that CCMB actually contributed a lot to the best of its ability during the pandemic for, I mean, during this pandemic, for many aspects of COVID research. These include training other people in diagnosing the virus and coming up with novel ways of diagnosis, the new ways of diagnosis, and sequencing multiple genomes to call for the variants that are there in the genome. We have been forefront of, we are one of the few labs in India which are at the forefront of sequencing efforts. We have sequenced almost 10,000 genomes in our CCMB in the past 1.5 years. We have established sewage surveillance, air surveillance to figure out if the virus, I mean, to figure out the spread of the virus. So, I mean, many other aspects. We screened many drugs for other agencies. Even today, we kind of help many other organizations in drug screening and many other aspects of COVID-related work. We are proud of that. And it has also taught us COVID research, or the COVID, the presence of pandemic has also taught us the value of research, the basic research specifically in the human health. The pipeline generally for a vaccine is generally considered to be around 8 to 10 years prior to COVID arrival. And it is actually quite amazing that a vaccine could be actually pulled out in about a year's time once the pandemic has appeared, which is an absolutely a terrific achievement. And a terrific achievement. And even we have an indigenous vaccine in Covaxin, which was done also in the same time period. This tells you how science has transformed the health sector, health, the human health and health sector in the context of this thing. So all these things are some of the aspects, and you know, some of these things that you can value how science contributes to the society, right? So we would, our hope is that Open Day actually provides an opportunity to all of you to kind of interact with students, scientists, and other leaders in science and understand what science is all about and be enthused by that. And some of you may end up becoming future leaders because of that, if this enthusiasm translates into a long-term interest in science. Please take this opportunity. Feel free to ask questions to our colleagues, students, and others. There are no bad questions to the best of my knowledge. It's only there are bad answers. Please use this opportunity to the fullest, and all the best to all of you. And thank you very much for participating in such large numbers. I look forward to a pretty conducive and very strong Open Day celebrations going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vinay, for your words. We'll be starting with our first session in 15 minutes. We'll be starting it at sharp 11 o'clock. Meanwhile, we'll play some social media content.
We are a country of 1.2 billion people. We look different from each other, speak different languages, and follow a variety of traditions. Where did we all come from?
To address this question, let us go to Africa, where the oldest human fossils known so far have been discovered. From there, humans have migrated to different parts of the world and established different populations. However, there is no proper record of these migrations. So scientists took the help of DNA to solve this mystery. DNA is a chemical molecule called deoxyribonucleic acid and is present in all our cells. It goes from one generation to the other. Since all the present existing populations have come from the oldest population in Africa, our DNA shows some similarities to the African DNA. No surprise there. But DNA is not a static molecule. It is made up of four building units called adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine, and its composition slowly changes with time. A unique DNA composition shows up in a population when it separates itself from others and starts breeding among themselves. But comparing our DNA with each other, we can predict how far away our roots are. A greater similarity means closer ancestry. Not only that, the number of differences in the DNA of two populations also estimates how long back the two populations separated from each other. This understanding helps us in finding out the ancestry of Indians. Dr. Lalji Singh and Dr. Kumaraswamy Thangaraj, scientists at the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, took up the challenge. They took blood and saliva samples as sources of DNA from people in various parts of India. They compared these DNA among each other and with the oldest human fossils found in Africa. Their studies find that two waves of migrations happened from Africa to India. The first one happened around 65,000 years ago. The people who came then populated the South India and went further to the Andaman Islands. They are called the ancestral South Indians. The second population from Africa came to India via Middle East and populated the North India. They are called the ancestral North Indians. But do not mistake the ancestral South and North Indians with the current South and North Indians. The ancestral South and North Indians intermixed with each other. You and I and all the Indians around us are largely a result of that intermixing. So, someone around you might think that they are different because of their caste, religion, language, or region. Tell them that they need to look into the details of their DNA. They will find that we come from the same ancestors. Presented to you by CSIR CCMB, CSIR Jigyasa, supported by Department of Science and Technology and National Council of Science and Technology Communication. To know more about CSIR CCMB's work, please visit www.ccmb.res.in.
My job is to make college easier because students have a lot on them.
Sorry, coach!
Manadi, 120 kotla janaba kaligina desham. Manam, okarikokari.
Did you know that some diseases run in families? These are passed on from parents to children and are called inheritable genetic diseases. Many Indians suffer from them. Why is it so? Can we prevent these diseases? Let's first understand where these diseases come from.
Research shows that in the last 2000 years, people in India have largely married and bred in their own small communities. As a result, every community has gathered unique mutations in the DNA of its people. But what are mutations? Imagine DNA to be a long thread made up of four kinds of building blocks: adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine, called as A, T, G, and C respectively. The long DNA thread is marked into smaller regions called genes. These genes hold information to make proteins, the little machines in the cells of our bodies. The ATGC sequence of these genes can randomly change over time. These are called as mutations. Most of these mutations are inconsequential, but some mutations alter the genes, such as the proteins become non-functional or dysfunctional. These can cause diseases and sometimes even death in the people carrying the faulty mutation. There can be two types of faulty mutations in genes, dominant and recessive. Cells usually contain two copies of genes, one inherited from each parent. Dominant mutations are those where just one copy of a mutated gene is sufficient to cause a disease. But these are rare. In case of recessive mutations, both the copies of a gene need to be mutated to cause a disease. People with just one copy of such a recessive mutation feel healthy and are often unaware of the mutation they carry in their gene. But the problem arises when two such people have biological children together. Their children can inherit two copies of the mutated gene and suffer from the disease. Such inheritable diseases due to both dominant and recessive mutations are called as genetic diseases. Some of the examples of genetic diseases are thalassemia, muscular dystrophy, sickle cell anemia, and cystic fibrosis. India is estimated to have about 70 million people suffering from genetic diseases. Dr. Kumaraswamy Thangaraj and Dr. Giriraj Chandak and other scientists at the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology have studied genes from various Indian populations. They have found mutations that are unique to Indians. These mutations are responsible for several diseases such as heart problems, neuromuscular diseases, chronic inflammation in pancreas and diabetes. The two-decade-long study shows that Indian populations have high incidence of genetic diseases due to marrying within small communities. But there are ways to stop the spread of genetic diseases. You can go to the doctor to get tested for some of the common faulty genes. If possible, choose a partner who does not carry the same faulty genes as you. One of the other ways is to marry or choose your partner who is not your relative or belongs to a different community. This way, the chances of both of you carrying the same faulty gene would be small. In case you and your partner have the same faulty gene, you can consult a medical geneticist or genetic counselor to make an informed choice on healthy life for you and your future children. Let us all strive to be a change maker to build a healthier India. Presented to you by CSIR CCMB, CSIR Jigyasa, supported by Department of Science and Technology and National Council for Science and Technology Communication. To know more about CSIR CCMB's work, please visit www.ccmb.res.in.
Hello everyone, we welcome you all to our first session for today. This session is conducted by the Fly Lab of CCMB and they will take you through the journey of how fruit fly is used as a model organism to uncover the life processes. So I welcome our first speaker, Aishwarya. Before that, I would tell you the format of asking the questions. The questions can be asked in your text. Type your questions in the chat boxes available in the YouTube live stream as well as in Zoom link. You can raise your hand at the end of session. And there is a Google form provided at the end of each session. It will be posted in the link as a link in YouTube. After each session, go to the Google form and give us the feedback. I'll hand over to the first speaker.
There is a camera.
Am I audible? Yeah. Okay, I'll start the session. Hi everyone, I'm Aishwarya. I'll initiate this session. So every one of you must have heard about the saying, small things make big differences. In this session, we are going to see how. So before we begin, let's talk a little bit about model organisms. These are the non-human species used in experiments, which help researchers to understand the biological processes. So one such model organism, which is widely used, is the fruit fly, which you often found hiding near fruits. This fly is called Drosophila melanogaster, and if we are to break this name, Droso means deep, phila is love. Melanogaster is the dark abdominal region of the fly. So shown here are the pictures of the two flies, which is our king and queen, basically the male and the female fly. So if you see the picture, the most prominent difference which you observe is the male is slightly smaller than the female, and the posterior abdominal region of the male is round, but the female has a more protruding and pointed region. So we'll see why Drosophila melanogaster is used as a model organism. So first is space. So in a single room, you can fit in like 6 to 10 monkeys or 100 to 200 rats, but you can fit in like lakhs. You can maintain lakhs of flies. So they require very little space. Second is the short generation span. Once the egg is laid, it takes about 24 hours to hatch into larvae. And then 2 to 5 larvae get matured, and then 6 to 10 day pupal stage, and then you get an adult fly. So the generation span is very short. Within 10 to 15 days, you can study the entire generation of the fly. Easy genetics, of course, because flies have 4 pair of chromosomes. So it's become very easy to study the heredity and to understand the chromosome associated traits. And economic. This is very economic because the maintenance charges and everything is very less. So the flies are very economic. Yes. Coming to this very important picture. For almost every Drosophila shows around 70% conservation with the humans. For almost every organ in human, there's a match in flies. So a variety of diseases affecting different organs can be studied. The diseases can be linked to digestive tract or nervous system, or body patterning, or blood disorders like leukemia, and all can be studied. Can the conditions can be mimicked in flies, and they can be studied. So this was the end of the why Drosophila uses a model organism. Then moving to the next part, what do we study? So I believe learning should be fun. So how about we learn the resource studies on Drosophila by playing a short game of spot the differences. Yes, so we all must have played this game. And so I'll be showing you two images on the screen, A and B. You'll have to spot the difference and type it in the chat box of the Zoom or YouTube. And there will be a timer of 15 seconds. So once you find the difference, even a 1 or 2 word answer will do. Just type the answer. The first image, this is the first image. In A, B, you see two male flies. So just spot this difference and tell. Wait a minute. Yes, time starts now. Yes. Correct. You can see that in this fly. This is a normal wild type fly. So your eye size, this is the compound eye of a Drosophila, which is composed of 800 small units. And in this fly there, which is the mutant fly, is showing eye deformities. So we can see in humans also, we can see such condition wherein we see eye deformities, and people get visually challenged because of that. So same condition can be mimicked in Drosophila, where it is showing this, where it is showing defect in eye development. So moving to the next image, this is the next picture. So you can see two female flies here, and your time starts now. Wait. Yeah, it starts now. Okay, done. So
majority of the answers are wings.
Wings, exactly. So here you can see two wings, and here you have four wings. So this condition is called ultrabiothorax. The phenotype is ultrabiothorax fly. So ultra is more, bi is two, and thorax is the thoracic region. So this phenotype is observed when a set of gene called HOX are mutated. So in humans also, if we see polydactyly condition, wherein the fingers, when more number of fingers, or syndactyly, where the fingers are fused. So this, there is a mutation in this locus of this, there's a mutation in this gene. You see this developmental deformities. Yeah, and HOX is basically a determinant of body axis patterning, so it also affects that. Moving on to the next slide. So this is an image of a Drosophila brain. We are looking into tissue now. This is a larval brain of Drosophila. So in brain A and brain B, what is the difference which you can see? Yeah, the time starts now. Okay, we are done. Any answers?
Brain size,
exactly. So the brain in B is smaller than A. This is a condition where the brain becomes small in size, is a microcephalic condition. And in humans also, we see this condition where the baby is born with a small brain condition. This is called microcephaly, and the same condition can be mimicked in flies as well. So suppose a gene X is responsible for small brain condition in humans, the Drosophila version of the same gene can lead to small brain condition in flies as well. So this is a very good system to study microcephaly. Yeah, so this was our last slide, and thank you guys for participating for the differences, and thank you for your participation. Moving on to the next part. So I ended it on genes. So what happens when the genes are not disciplined, and how can we use Drosophila to study them? So I'll give you a very beautiful example of one gene, which is called ILS. So if you see this image, you can see this is a Drosophila eye where it is supposed to be, but in antenna also you can see the eye of a Drosophila. In wings also you can see. If you zoom in a bit, yeah. So you can clearly see in antenna of the fly, the eye has started developing. So this happens when this eyeless gene, it starts working where it is not supposed to work, and the gene product, because of its misbehavior, you can see eyes everywhere. So even if misregulation of one gene can lead to such drastic phenotype, and we can use Drosophila for studying it. You can study the function of the gene, you can find it partners in crime, and you can also find the factors which is responsible for it. So yeah, this was the end of the first session. So we have studied what do we study. Now we'll see how do we study it, and most importantly, where do we study it. So we can, I'll hand it over to Shubhanshu, my colleague, and he'll explain you that. Over to you, Shubhanshu.
audible? So hello everyone. So now you all have a very general idea about the fruit fly, that is Drosophila melanogaster. The fly facility at Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, Hyderabad, has different kinds of flies that are used for various kinds of experiments. We will now go through a virtual tour of the fly facility, which is divided into three themes. The first theme is store and grow, then meet and screen, and the third one is dissect and ponder. So yeah, this is our workplace. The fly lab at CCMB has two rooms with 14 workbenches, an incubator room, a stock room, imaging room, a microinjection room, and a discussion room. Let's now talk about the storage and growth of flies. So yeah, the most essential thing to grow flies is the food. It consists of corn flour, sugar, yeast, agar, and malt. It contains propionic acid, methyl benzoic acid, and orthophosphoric acid as preservative. The flies can be stored and cultured in a bottle or a vial. I'll be a little louder. The flies can be stored in bottles or vials. Bottles are used for large number of flies, but when the experiments require a smaller number of flies, vials are used. Flies consume food both in bottles and vials approximately in 10 to 15 days, and hence a new bottle and a vial is used to transfer the flies and continue the culture. Am I audible? Or should I be a little louder? I'm audible, right? This is the incubator room. Incubators can be set at various temperature according to the need. The ideal temperature for growth of flies is 25 degrees Celsius. Both vials and bottles can be stored in incubators. Incubators also have lights so as to maintain a normal day and night cycle for the flies. Okay, so this is the stock room. The stock room is used to keep a safe copies of all the flies that are used in the experiments. The temperature in this room is set to 18 degrees Celsius so as to decrease the speed of development of fly from an embryo to an adult. As a result, the vials in the bottles at this temperature can be kept for longer periods without being changed in every 10 to 15 days. So this was about the fly facility that we work in. Now I would like to hand it over to Lorraine, who would guide you through the second theme of the tour, that is mate and screen. Thank
Good morning, everyone. I'm Lorraine. So the basics of fly work, they include the setting up of crosses between males and females that are actually morphologically distinguishable between each other. Okay, so once we set up the crosses in vials, they lay eggs or embryos that actually they form larvae within 24 hours. And these pupate to form adults within a period of around 10 days. So to observe the flies, we use a stereo binocular microscope with a fine adjustment and a coarse adjustment. This is also fitted with a light source and a carbon dioxide pad. The carbon dioxide pad is porous, which allows the CO2 to pass through and immobilize our flies just for a long enough period so that we can get a glimpse into their morphology without causing them any permanent damage. The crosses are set up in vials containing an ample source of food. And once we have gathered all the required information from our flies, we discard them in a vessel containing propionic acid. So many of our studies also include flies in the embryonic stage. So for this, we use the setup that is shown in the picture. Here, the base of this consists of a food plate, which is made up of a grape agar jelly. And the flies, they feed off the yeast paste that we put on this. And they also lay their eggs here, which make it easy for collection. This is the entire setup of how we actually anesthetize and immobilize our flies. using an injectometer for CO2 via a CO2 tapping pad and a CO2 gun. Now, the pressure of the CO2 is also regulated at the source. Now, when the CO2 setup is usually, it works on electricity, but when power systems fail, we have an ether setup to fall back on. And this is the setup that you can see in the picture, which allows the flies to come in contact with just enough ether to actually immobilize them without causing them any permanent damage. Next, I would like to hand over the session to Brinda, who will guide us through the third theme, dissect and ponder.
I hope I'm audible.
Hello.
I hope I'm audible now. Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm Brinda. Now, I'll take you to this particular theme, that is dissect and ponder. And I'll tell you about dissections. So to observe certain tissues in the fly, we need to dissect these tissues and take it out, and that we do it in PBS. To do this, we use certain dissection tools. As you can see, this is the dissection toolkit, and which consists of the following, that is the dropper, the fine scissors, syringe, fine forceps, needle, and magnifying glass. And these are the tissues, that is dissected tissues, which are being shown. So the testes, the third instar larvae, brains, and the ovaries. So we then take these tissues out and mount these tissues on the slide, which further is taken for the imaging. So this is a particular imaging setup. This is one such example shown, and the microscope, which consists of camera, capture the image, and this setup, computer setup for live imaging, where we can view these whatever we are imaging. So this is one particular example of how we image the tissues. And now this comes to the end of our session, and we will move on to a short fun quiz. And to join the quiz, please use QR code or the link which is shared on the MS Teams as well as the YouTube, or you can either go to menti.com and enter the code shown, that is 89587927. The faster you answer, the more points you will score. So we should now take a short break of 3 to 4 minutes so that you guys can scan the QR code and be ready for the quiz. So now we are going to start the quiz. I hope all of you have scanned the QR code and got ready for the quiz. So the winner of the quiz is Ayush Goel. Now this comes to the end of our quiz session. Now we'll move on to the interactive session, and I invite Ravina and Nikhil to address the questions.
Hello everyone. It's been a wonderful session and a lot of spamming was also around. We hope to not have any more spamming during the Q&A session. There are a couple of questions that we received in different channels, and I'll try to address as much as possible. To begin with, Ashutosh Singh had asked that how Drosophila research can help in survival of cancer patients. So that's a very good question. In Drosophila, you genes, you can see that how the pathophysiology is, and then you can accordingly target each one of them and see that how what drug can be effective. So for that, you can treat viruses, you can treat the cancer pathophysiology in a very short time. So within 1 month, 2 months, you would know if a drug is working or not. You would know that what are the pathways that are involved, and then you can help cancer patients by fast tracking the process of drug development. You cannot directly correlate the research on Drosophila to patients. You have to translate it clinically to mouse clinical trials and then move on further with the drug production and manufacturing. And then we also move with human clinical trials before it actually reaches the patients. So yeah, it's a long-term process, but it fast tracks the development. Other than this, there are some questions that we have received. So one is, other than zebrafish, Drosophila and Arabidopsis, are there any other model organisms? Yes, there are many. So people use yeast, people use nematode, which is C. elegans, they use mouse, frog, and multiple people. And now that we know how to manipulate the genome, it is also easier to work with different organisms and not just have a couple of models.
Nikhil, there is one question. There is one question which asks how can we edit desired gene in Drosophila? I think you can reply it better. How can we edit a desired gene?
Right, that's a great question. In 2020, Jennifer Doudna and Emmanuel Charpentin got a Nobel Prize for the discovery of CRISPR-Cas9 gene editing system in chemistry. And that is one of the systems through which you can manipulate the genome. So essentially you target your sites with a protein called Cas9, and then you use a sort of reader that helps in reading the sequence of the DNA and helps in identifying where you have to edit it. So you clone it. So you essentially clone these resources and you help the protein or the scissor to reach wherever you want to cut, copy, paste, or do whatever kind of manipulations that you want to do, and then guide your system accordingly. So there are a lot of systems that are available for gene editing.
There is one question which asks how to select the drug based on targeting part in body. So to Drosophila, we actually feed any drugs in food. We mix it, like we measure the quantity and we standardize everything, and then we feed it via food. So that is the delivery mechanism. And I think that answers. Another question is, I want to ask what specific functions of DNA, genes, and chromosome we can change according to wish. So one is the DNA mutation we can do. We can do deletion, we can do insertion, we can also do point mutation. I hope you all. So point mutation is changing in one base pair, and deletion is like removing one chunk of DNA, and insertion is like inserting one chunk your target region or sequence of interest. You can insert it. Likewise, you can also mutate gene at different locus. So there are multiple
domains of a gene, which are like the 5' and 3', or sometimes introns, sometimes exons. So you can target those via these gene editing mechanism, which already Nikhil has told you. So these are few things we can look into by editing genes. And other things, we can see the chromatin features, like what is their 3D organization, how they function, how some active genes come together, some inactive genes, they reside in particular domain. These kind of information we can also get. So I hope this answers your questions. And again, how can we check the chemicals? So I don't understand these questions properly. Nikhil, if you understand this, then you can reply. How can?
So I'll try answering some. One question is by Shagun Sharma, and she's asking that what type of media you use for growing fly. So we use cornmeal agar, and we put some sucrose in it, we put some antifungal agents and preservatives, and we just let it solidify. So when you make it, it's essentially liquid, so you can pour it into the vials, and then because of the agar, it solidifies after some time, and then you transfer the flies into it. The next question is by Trishala Manoj, that are the fruit flies harmful? They are absolutely not. Fruit flies are absolutely harmless to any known animal, plant, or human. So you can use it for research purpose the way that you would want it. They don't spread any diseases. The next question is COVID affecting Drosophila, or is there any research going on it? This question is asked by Pratiksha Dutari. Pratiksha, this is a good question. To go as similar to how you know where your house is, you will never land up into anybody else's house, right? Similarly, virus know they have a particular key to enter lock of a particular host or a particular cell. So the COVID-19 virus, the COVID-19 pandemic, which is spread by SARS-CoV-2, has access only to human lungs or a certain species of mammals like bats and rhesus monkeys, right? But certainly not the flies. Then so Kaveri is asking a very important question, that whether we can edit DNA in human beings also. That's a good question, and that's a very serious question. So recently, a couple of months back, there is a committee formed by WHO that is now processing the rules and regulations of manipulating human genome, because the potential is tremendous, but we should know where to stop and we should know where to really do our research with. So you can go to WHO portal and you can look for gene editing protocols for humans, and it's in process.
Nagam Shiva asked why CO2 is used. So CO2 is used for anesthetizing the fly so that we can work. So it doesn't kill the fly for some time if you treat it for like seconds, and it provides you the opportunity to make unconscious the animal, and you can perform your experiments, or you can sort them and you can screen them, collect them. That's how it works. And the other question is, what are the uses of fruit fly? So basically, we use fruit fly to study in our lab. And I don't think in natural condition it is any use, except it maintains the ecological system. Like, it is also one of the insects. And sometimes it is harmful for fruits because it can destroy, it lays its egg in fruits. So it can destroy in laboratory we use Drosophila for multiple studies. Like, we can use behavioral studies, we can use genetic study for genetic diseases, we can use it for study for neuronal diseases. Likewise, we can use this, and as you know, we can alter its genome by a genome editing method. So we study these things. Other questions. What is the meaning of DNA? How is it works? So DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid. So DNA is normally your genetic material. So it contains the messages from your parents, and then it is dictated by some of enzymes in your body, and based on that your body structure is formed and function. So DNA is basically the message carrier of your body, and you get
so
it
all those who your... have questions on DNA, all those who have questions on DNA, please feel free to join our upcoming session on DNA, the thread of life, which is at 1:15 p.m. today, right? So make sure you save a lot of your questions for that particular session, because it is focused on DNA. We are more interested in answering questions that pertaining to fly as a model organism. So one question is asked by Ananya, which is there any antibody which recognizes Drosophila? I'm sorry, Ananya, but antibodies are targeted against proteins, and Drosophila is an animal. So it has thousands of proteins in it. So you can target Drosophila proteins, but there is no such thing as an antibody that can that so-called recognizes the whole organisms. You always recognize it based on the small epitopes that are there in the antigens, which is the counterpart of the antibodies which recognize them. Okay, so we are getting a lot of questions about DNA. Okay, for that you have to stay back with us for some time. Zuveria is asking if Drosophila carries COVID-19 virus. No, it doesn't. Okay, for all of you who are not yet done with asking questions, and because we are overwhelmed with questions, we'll ask you to kindly write us to flyroom@csirccmb.org. You can also send us messages on our official Facebook channel or Twitter channel, whatever suits you. We'll try to answer as many questions as possible. But for the time being, and with respect to the time constraint, we would like to end our session for here, and see you back again next time. Till then, have a great, good day, and keep visiting our sessions for the rest of the day and for CCMB. Thank you.
Okay, there is one question, which is how fruit flies make an impact in our ecosystem. So like you know, flies, they sometimes involve in pollination. So that is that they can be like they can harbor pollens on their wings, on their legs, so they can do the pollination things. So that's how they maintain the. And the second thing is they can be food for other predators. So the other predators can be food for the next lineage. So that's how they maintain the food chain as well. So this is the, I hope this, and Nikhil, if you want to add something.
No, I think that sums up it really well. Thank you.
And guys, at the end of this session, if you like this session, so please give a feedback to us, and then fill a form. The link is in chat box, so you can fill whatever you felt about this session. And I hope you like this. So here we end this session. Okay.